Get specific in your prayers. Okay? God's just waiting there. God wants fellowship with us. He wants His story working through us. Well, what's the best way to get His story working through us? Living life like we want to, or submitting and allowing Him to live through us, His plan? That's the key. So, for our lives, He wants beauty from ashes. What the canker worm has destroyed, He wants to restore to us. Amen? That means our children. Amen? What the enemy took, we're going to take back in Jesus' name. Amen? The enemy does not win this thing.
It's something that you can do, and you can do not only with the Lord and with friends and family, and I can assure you, they'll love your baby.
Yes.
As soon as that baby is born, they're going to say it was their idea. They're going to say that baby looks like grandma, or that baby looks like Uncle Eddie, it's going to look like grandpa. Or what matters is they're going to love your baby.
Amen.
And Amen. You're going to love your baby, and you're not going to be destroyed in the process. Because, see, that's the other side that's not told.
Okay.
As difficult as it may be with an unplanned pregnancy, the greater sorrow is when a baby has been terminated. We'll use that kind word right here.
Okay.
It is a murder. An abortionist, you know, this is a hired killer, okay?
Yes.
But the woman, as soon as this baby is gone, they may feel a sense of relief initially, but then they begin to think upon it, and they start seeing other babies. They start seeing other children. They start getting a little bit older and thinking about, I want to get married, and I want children of my own. And then this little one that has been terminated, that its life has been taken so young, begins to loom very largely in their hearts and in their minds, and it's torment. So the enemy, who has convinced you to get out of the situation because it's embarrassing or it's shameful or it's not timely, it's going to interfere with life, then when this is all said and done and the baby is gone and you're tormented, then Satan will accuse you. Look what you did. You're evil. You're a terrible mother.
Yes.
And he turns on you. And then the woman has torment in her heart. And many times, as you well know, they'll turn to alcohol or drugs or other sexual encounters or prostitution or all kinds of things to escape those emotions, to justify it. You don't have to stay in shame or guilt. You can be a woman that experiences loss of that baby. You can be the woman that is brought along by the Lord and the Holy Spirit to be able to grieve the child that was lost, that was taken from you. And you need to be able to grieve that baby. There was a time that as a pro-life and pregnancy crisis counselor and working with young women, or women of any age, but in particular young women, unplanned pregnancies, I would look at the woman and love the woman, and yet my focal point was on the baby, to save the baby.
Right.
Certainly I wanted the woman saved, but my greatest passion was the baby. And I began to realize that I was missing the whole picture.
Mm.
I was missing that, yes, this is her baby and should be protected and not killed.
Right.
But that this was a package deal. Now, I know today's day is different. People are telling and it's being exploited, you know, as a good thing. But it's not. It is a travesty to you, to the child, to the father of the child, to the grandparents, to society. The enemy is after the whole family. He's after the human race. As I began to be quickened by the Lord to have as much passion to see the woman saved as the child,
yes,
along with the rest of the family, I just so happened to be going to a psychiatric ward to visit someone that was a family member that was in great turmoil because of loss in their life. Mm-hmm. There was a woman there that was comforting me concerning the family member. Mm-hmm. And I thought, wow, is this a nurse? Is this a social worker? She was very kind and helpful and comforting me. Mm. And she asked me to sit down with her and that her family was there. I began to realize she was a patient. And I thought, well, we just seem like we're peers. She seems very professional and in control. What's this about? And I began to look at some pictures. She had some family members there. Looked at some pictures, and in the picture, she was pregnant. And it was obvious that it had been recently. And I said, oh, and I'm gonna use her name, Gwen. It's not really her name, but I'll use the word Gwen. And I said, Gwen, do you have a new baby or a young baby? And before my eyes, she began to get very, very nervous. Her eyes began to shift back and forth. She began to kind of twitch, frankly. She was having an emotional breakdown right in front of me, an anxiety attack right in front of me, mm-hmm. and began to explain that she was older, her husband didn't want this child, and she was getting, it was more of a late-term abortion, wow. and she was getting older, and the doctor now says he doesn't know for sure if the baby's okay. So she began to talk very rapidly, and I'm a Christian, and I love God, and I can't believe I did this. And so it was getting real panicky, and I knew she was getting very excited, and I said, Gwen, is there a drink of water around here? The Lord had orchestrated this meeting, and he just told me to stay with her, to love her. But we were getting some attention. So we went around the corner to get a drink of water. And I was telling Jamie, I kind of did a scoot over in my own body in the temple of the Spirit of God, which we are. And
Amen.
Jesus just began to love her and speak to her and literally did this. Shh. Because she kept justifying.
Wow.
Do not excuse your sin any longer.
Amen.
Do not justify your sin any longer. Come to me. Ask me to forgive you of your sin.
Yes.
I will forgive you and heal you and make you whole.
Amen.
She stopped. The madness stopped. The anxiety attack stopped as Jesus was looking at her through my eyes.
Yes.
And she began to weep. She covered her face. And she cried and cried and asked Jesus to forgive her.
Amen.
Confessed it as sin, that she
Amen.
Knew better.
Amen.
And I got to speak on his behalf.
Yes, Lord.
He forgives you. Now you can move on. You can
ask
be healed.
Ask for that forgiveness.
Ask for the forgiveness.
Yes.
You're forgiven. And you know, her whole face changed.
Countenance
her countenance changed. She was shiny.
Wow, radiant.
Radiant with the Spirit of Christ
Amen.
In her right mind now. with soundness of mind, mm-hmm. and peace in her heart. And we walked arm in arm, and she, tears were flowing, and she was saying, thank you, thank you, thank you for coming. Thank you. I said, well, thank the Lord. He Amen. Sent me. And we walked to the door. It was time for me to leave. The nurse had to unlock the door because it had gates. I mean, wow. and it was had bars on it.
Yeah.
So intense. So I stepped out. We gave our last hug. And I started to walk away. I waved. And then she called out, Sherry, Sherry. And I went back. And she's looking at me through bars of an institution. Tell the women. Tell them they can be forgiven.
The Lord bless you. You see why I was so excited about having this interview with Sherry. Bless you, Sherry. Thank you.
Bless you, brother.
Mission Messiah is an 18-month program for women and women with children.
Those real-life experiences are what should make truth easily entreated.
Our desire is to see women set free from life-debilitating substances and events. Our program is solidly based on Jesus Christ and His plan of living. Our emphasis on biblical study, scripture memorization, life skill development, and renewed family living is interconnected to bring wholeness back to hopeless lives.
And the Son and the Holy Spirit.
WOW Warehouse and Zip Business Services developed out of the need for practical job training and discipleship. They are flourishing businesses filled with our graduates and trainees. Is Mission Messiah the answer for someone you know?
Such an anointing
yes.
on what you're doing. And I don't know what the battles you've been fighting, but God does. And so we're just gonna lay hands on you and just pray with you. So Dustin, why don't you just lead out and let's just gather around Jamie right quick.
God, I thank you that the women that are in Mission Messiah, God, that come from so many backgrounds, they're encountering you because of the love that this man has for them. Mission Messiah TV, God, would it not just be a regional show, but may it actually be something that goes in here to Dallas and in Fort Worth and other places, God. Would you connect the dots for this incredible ministry? Would you continue to bless the work of your hands? Continue to send these girls that are in need, God, and would you continue to allow them to see the miracles that are taking place?
Yes.
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 Amen. I thank you that the mind that you've given him, the mind of Christ, and the yes. wisdom you've placed in his life, that they're now being used
yes.
to advance your kingdom.
Yes.
It goes beyond the walls of a church.
Yes.
It goes beyond an organization.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you're beginning to highlight problems
yes.
in him.
Yes. Yes.
And you're beginning to highlight in his past experience yes. that things, the tools you gave him to fix Jesus. Those problems. And I think that you're bringing people around him that he doesn't feel the pressure or the responsibility of making it happen. Do mighty works for the kingdom.
Jesus. Yes.
Specifically in technology.
Yes.
Specifically in technology. In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Jesus' name.
Yes.
Thank you.
Here we are.
Here we are. As you can tell, I'm at the salon.
We are back here with Linda, our stylist.
I'm getting my hair did.
And we thought, you know, this is one of our very favorite places to come because we love to talk about Jesus and we love to talk with Linda. Linda and I, every single time we come to the salon,
We talk Jesus.
So we call it church at the salon.
Well, you know, church is not just in a certain four walls. It's everywhere you are because we are the church.
We are the church.
You know, one of the things I've noticed lately is a lot of people saying, who've lost loved ones, a lot of people saying he earned his angel wings. And it's made me stop and think. And I brought it up to you.
Yes.
And you clarified angels for me. And it was such a revelation.
One of the things that I love for people to understand is the Word of God declares that you and I will become saints. We do not become angels. Angels are only created beings. They were created, the Word says they were created even before the world came into being.
Wow.
So angels are a created being. They're not and never have been, nor will they ever be human. And so that's one of those little misconceptions that we deal with.
And they were created for a purpose. They have specific purposes, angels.
They are for our protection,
mm-hmm.
and they are warriors. And that is one of the main things that I think we get this little misconstrued image or imagery of angels. You see pictures of angels that are these beautiful little
blonde
female angels with wings and carrying their little tiny harp. And that's just not reality.
Well, that's not biblical.
It's not. Angels were created primarily for protection. And there's not one single reference in the Word of God to a female angel. Now, how about that?
How about that?
Angels are male. Think about the names that you know. Many of us know the names that are in the Word. We hear of Gabriel.
We do.
And we hear of Michael.
Michael.
Michael has one purpose. He is the protector. He is the guardian.
The most amazing statue of Michael, of the angel Michael that I ever saw and you saw with me, was at Edinburgh Castle in Scotland. There is a room that is literally three stories, and when you walk in, all you see are the feet of this angel. And then you look up and he's holding a sword and his wings are down. He's wearing armor. He is the warrior angel who does battle for us.
And then there's Gabriel. And the way we know most about Gabriel is he is, for a good term, he is the announcer. He is who was sent to Mary to tell about Jesus.
Yes.
He is the announcer. He is the one that sends forth messages.
Good tidings,
messenger.
Great joy.
There
yes.
it is.
Yeah.
And that is an angel. Now, do we have guardian angels? Indeed, we do. The Word's clear that we each have a guardian angel, but that's not a human.
That is not a human, nor a human that's passed on. So those who have passed on are saints, but they are not angels. And in a way, that's very, very soothing to me. You know, we have our own guardian angels. God gives us those.
And most of us have had an encounter where we know that our guardian angel has been in charge.
Absolutely. You let go and let God.
But it's just an interesting thought. The next time that you do hear someone say, well, my mother is an angel in heaven. No, if she was a believer, she's a saint. And you and I have angels that protect us, but they're God's mighty creation.
I am here in gorgeous Kerrville today with Shay Spencer.
Hello. Shay, how are you?
I am blessed to see you and to hear what God's doing in you today, and to have just gotten a few bites of where you were.
Mm-hmm.
Would you mind? Because, you know, the thing we want to do is see Jesus lifted up.
Amen. Glorified.
And so,
yes.
Where were you? How'd you get there?
So in 2005, I began doing drugs heavily. I was doing drugs for many years off and on, but heavily doing drugs, getting into a crowd that was heavily involved in organized crime.
Wow.
And so I used...
So you went big time.
I went big time.
Okay.
And I used my brain for bad. And the Lord is, you know, the very gifts that He's given me today, I use them. They're no different. I realize that the gifts are irrevocable.
Yeah. The enemy wants to steal those gifts,
yes.
Use them for destruction.
Mm-hmm.
God deposited them within
yes.
you for His glory.
Yes.
Okay.
And I took what He gave me, and I used it for bad. And even on the street, you know, out in that world, I remember still wanting to help people. So if somebody would come around me and they needed a place to stay, or I would find people and I would say, what's wrong? You know, do you need something? And they used to tell me, actually, they said, you're different than we are. And so even then I loved people.
Yes.
I was just really hurt and I was really devastated by life. I had made some really poor choices. I had a daughter out of wedlock with someone who was extremely abusive. And so I just couldn't handle the pain anymore, and so I left my daughter with my parents and took off.
Wow.
So that took about a year and a half, the Lord chasing me the whole time.
Relentless pursuit.
Just coming after me. And
yeah.
And I look back now and I think,
when you say that, what did that look like? How was He coming after you like that?
Oh, goodness. I look back now. Even one of the things that just is coming to me right now, I was going down an alley, and it was not a good situation. It wasn't a good place.
Wasn't a good alley to be in.
Wasn't a good alley. And I remember I was going to take a right. And I know now it was the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And He said, mm-mm, don't go that way. Go that way.
Oh, wow.
So I said, okay. So I go that way, but come to find out there was that other, that would have led to possible death because of what happened there. And so, and rape, it was really, it was a trap by the enemy, but the Lord was even merciful.
I got the chill all over me, girl.
And there are certain times when I was running for my life, literally. Somebody was trying to set me up, and I was wrong. And I literally came in on them trying to set me up. And the guy was actually talking on the phone to the DEA. And anyway, I walked up on it and I said, okay, I'm out of here. Don't think that this is good. That would have put me underneath the prison cell for many, many years to come. And
but God's timing.
But His timing, He was just merciful. I deserved what was coming.
Right.
I mean, my actions deserved punishment. And
don't we all,
but He was merciful and He loved me and He saved me. And I, you
in
know,
pursuit.
And so I took off. It was, there's a whole story with that, but basically, how I got home that night, I will, and home being a guardian angel, literally,
yeah.
Somebody that saved me that was not in the life, that it was just home base when I just couldn't take it anymore. But He was taking people away is what happened.
Okay.
He took person after person after person, and everybody was getting 50 years, 20 years, 50, this, that, just
so
everybody's popping
people,
like flies.
This group you were running with, they were falling out.
Because they were after us. So I was scared for my future, for my daughter's future. I never wanted to hurt her. I just was hurting myself.
Right.
And so I thought, I've got to go get some help. And my grandmother, who said, you know, if anybody can come out of this, Che, you can. And
come
I'm like,
on.
Okay, so I go check myself into rehab because I had a bunch of charges and I thought that that would look good at the court too.
Right.
So I thought, well, let me, at this time, still not having my mind truly wrapped around what I was in and doing. I just knew it wasn't right.
Right.
So I go to Serenity House in Abilene, Texas, and stay there for 30 days. And actually, it ended up being more like 40 because I had some back issues. But so anyway, get out of there and thought, well, I'm better because I met the Lord in there. The Lord was just so faithful to show himself in very supernatural ways in there.
Come on.
And I remember after the third step prayer one time, I walk outside and all I saw was three for 5 minutes. Three things on the wall, three people, three churches, three, not really realizing what he was doing yet. I asked my grandparents to send me a Bible in there, so I started reading the Bible.
Okay.
And but still not having the depth that I needed to not go back out. Right. I mean, I wasn't done, and I like to say that because the Lord knew what I needed, and so the charges stuck, and I ended up having to go to jail, and I got to be in a program. Now, I was fighting. I was only out for 7 days from rehab, and they said, you need to turn yourself in. And I said, okay, I'll do that. Mm-hmm. So I turned myself in, and they said, you're gone. It stuck. And I said, okay, how long? Now, I was looking at a lot of time, but I only had to do 6 month program. So it was really a blessing.
Yeah.
And
favor and mercy.
Favor and mercy. I had Belinda Hill, who was just famous for throwing the book at people, and they said, you're gone. You're done. And I said, I'll be gone as long as he wants me gone. And that's really what I believe.
So your faith was already solidifying.
He told me, even in the cells, he said, you'll never be anywhere. If you walk with me, you'll never be anywhere longer than you're supposed to be. You know, and it was just kind of, so I thought.
Isn't that our God?
Amen. I said, okay. So I surrendered. And I went in and went to the program. Didn't see the light of day because it was a program where you didn't go outside. So stayed in there.
So literally no light of the day.
No light of the day for real. So I was in there for 6 months and it was awesome because, and I say that, you know, most people wouldn't say that about jail. But I got to read the word and he got to talk to me. He needed me still.